Thank you, guys. We're very excited to be here today. My name is Mike Phillips, the Vice President of Marketing for Lionel. It's definitely an honor to be here. This is my sixth chance to get to come to a York show, and every year we get to bring out more and more new and exciting products. So each time it kind of always adds to the excitement we have new items to bring to the table. On a quick note, I wanted to share Howard Hitchcock, our Lionel president, sends his regrets. He is tied up with previous obligations and unable to make it today, but he will be at our booth Thursday and Friday, so definitely stop by, say hi. He always loves coming to the event and seeing all of our train fans and our hobbyists throughout the industry. Quickly wanted to kind of show you guys a few things that we presented this spring, but that throughout the course of the year we were really able to bring to life. One of the first ones we're really excited about is this past spring, Howard talked to you guys a little bit about the program that we were running to kick off, really allowing consumers to design their own boxcar. And part of the program, and it was a contest that we ran nationally, and we picked 16 finalists, we had consumers vote, and we had over 10,000 votes to select the favorite, the fan favorite for the boxcar. And so what we did was, if everybody saw in their C2 catalog, we brought this gentleman's car to life, so it's gonna be made in the USA. His name is Booth Rankins. I think it's a gorgeous car. He designed a great piece. We had a really fun event. You can see from the photos that Booth was able to come to our office in North Carolina, and here's one of the first samples that we've made of Booth's car. So really excited to see the passion that he had, all the submissions and entries that we had, plus over 10,000 votes, really kind of made it something fun and something a little bit different to really start to get people engaged and kind of getting some new options and things that we can do. So definitely excited about that item. One of the other items that we have coming up this fall is, really for the first time in a long time, Lionel's kicking off our very first National Lionel Train Day. So this year, on December 5th, we have over 140 dealers throughout the country. Everybody's kicking off their own event in all the locations. So you can come to our website, you can find an event near you, it's sorted by state. But what's really cool is that, you know, we're using national media. If you guys are familiar with the past 2 years, we've been fortunate enough to be on things like Fox and Friends, Good Morning America, really trying to get to these places to start to help bring the excitement, the passion for model trains to the next generation and use the voice of the brand to help draw more foot traffic into our local dealers. So every year from here on out, the first Saturday of December is gonna be National Lionel Train Day, and part of that event is gonna be exclusive product. And the only way you can get this boxcar is actually to go into one of our participating dealers. So it's a really nice piece. It's gonna be a unique piece that you have to get into this location. So really adds a little bit of a cachet to the piece. It's a little bit more exclusive, it's a little bit more unique, but really excited to be doing something. And excited too that with 140 of different groups and locations participating, there's more than likely gonna be an event near you to kind of go check out. And as the brand, we sent out some really good materials and some kits to kind of help out to really amp up the event and the excitement that everybody's gonna be having. So definitely check it out, come to our website, and find one of the events and the locations near you. And the last piece that I just want to do quickly is thank the National Toy Train Museum. It's always a privilege and an honor for us to get to be here. It's always an exciting time. We want to thank all of you guys as the fans for coming in. It's really exciting to get to present these new products and kind of watch your faces react. As you guys see, you guys connect with different ones. That's part of the excitement and the magic for us. So on behalf of that, we'd like to present one of our Lion Chief Plus NW2 engines to the Toy Train Museum. So again, thank you for everything that you guys do for us in terms of helping us reach the consumers, helping us reach the audience, and really keeping the magic of toy trains and model trains alive. So thank you guys again, appreciate everything. And then with that, I will hand it over to Matt Ashba to introduce to you guys some of the other products that we have in the line coming out this year.
Thanks a lot, Mike, and thanks everybody here for taking the time to come down and listen to us and to some of the other presenters before us. And thank you to the museum. We really appreciate the chance to come here and spend some time with you. And it does sort of feel like a home away from home for Lionel, and we look forward to continuing these two times a year for York to be able to come here and have some time with you. Mike had shown you a couple of U.S. made box cars, the award winner, the Booth Rankins, and then the special one for the National Lionel Train Day. Both of those are U.S. made, and we have another one here. It's a Smithsonian. I just want to mention those other cars again because all of these have really, really good graphics. These are made, printed in the U.S., and I think they do a lovely job. We actually are able to do more, I think, with the printing here. There's a little bit more customization we can do here than we can do overseas. The other special thing is the fact that we have more leverage or latitude for running smaller numbers. So I think it allows us as a company to be able to react quicker and to be able to do special runs of cars that we might not have been able to do in the past. So for instance, the National Train Day car, there may be very few of those compared to other cars in our line that we actually produce. And so I think there's certainly an added collectability to some of these U.S.-made cars. The one that Ryan was holding up there, that one's a Smithsonian. That was that's a new license we have that we had first promoted in the C2 catalog of 2015. We're really excited to be able to continue that relationship with Smithsonian as we move forward into 2016 with some new products. As always, keep your eyes peeled for new licenses that we have, new relationships. Shell is another type of, we had a Shell tank car in the signature C2 catalog of 2015. And that's another license that you're going to see more of as we move to the new year. And then, of course, Coca-Cola and a lot of other main brands, Polar Express, that we are very happy to be aligned with. I have the pleasure to be able to talk to you about the traditional section of our line today. Ryan here, after I'm through, will move to our scale line and show you some really awesome stuff that we have coming up. But let me just give you guys a little quick glimpse of some new things that we have coming out that are part of our traditional line. Our ready-to-run train sets, of course, are a very important core part of the Lionel line. And as you know by now, Lion Chief is really the system that we use for all of our ready to run train sets. The world of transformer train sets by Lionel, that really is a thing of the past. To be able to have the ability to have your ready to run train set that you can control with that remote control, whether you're 5 or 95, is just a very easy, very convenient thing. And as many of you know, These engines, these sets, run better than ever and have a lot of great features to them. Ryan is holding up right now one set. It's the Patriot set, and he's holding up a U-36B. I brought this one because, number one, it's the first time that we've shown this set. It will be shipped in November, I believe. And this is one of the new diesel engines that have been added to our Lion Chief line. So as we move forward, we are continually expanding and growing what we're doing for the ready-to-run line, for our traditional line, as well as what we're doing for a lot of the higher-tier products as well. It's important for us at Lionel to find products that fit all of our different fans who all have their own passions. And I think this ready-to-run train line is one of them. This U-36B here, this is the second scheme we have. These, by the way, are hobby exclusive sets. We have in our catalog specific sets that are set aside that you can only get through your hobby dealer. And we're really proud of the fact that we can isolate those and do some special things with them that we might not do otherwise. This chassis set's a little higher end. And the fact that it has the die-cast sprung trucks on the freight cars, it's a 4-freight car set along with the U-36B. The U-36B has dual motors. You have your cab light on the inside, the nice metal frame and metal rails. The hopper that you see here is a new car, actually, in our line. This is a wood chip hopper, and as you can see from the car there, you now have the nice extended top portion that has been added to our traditional quad or 4-bay hopper. So you'll be seeing more of this wood chip type car in our line, and this is really the first place that we have used it in this chassis U-36B freight set. As you can see with the Patriot, we have a nice scheme there that all of the cars follow sort of that inspired bicentennial decoration that you see on many of the real railroad cars and locomotives as well. The second engine that we added to our Lion Chief line in 2015 is our Docksider. This is part of our ready-to-run train line, but it is a nice little engine. It's die-cast metal frame and body. You have directional lighting on there, figures on the interior. It's really a neat little piece. And this, we have it in two sets for 2015. The one that Ryan is holding is our Santa's Helper, and it sort of has that Santa's elves theme, so to speak, where you have a work caboose and presents and a gondola with presents. There's a separate sail crane that you can buy, and all these sort of fit together in this nice little Santa's Helper theme. He's also holding up the boxcar that comes in this Christmas set. This will be available, of course, for Christmas for this year. So we really, really like this for the holidays. Another added feature for this Santa's Helper set is the fact that it comes with a piece of plug-and-play track. And this is a lock-on that's in front of Ryan right there. That actually is thrown in for free into your Santa's Helper set. Now, what that lock-on does is it gives you access to, could you give me that that box, the big red orange box? I'm not going to take it out right now, but this contains the classic icing station that all of you or most of you are familiar with Lionel. Items like this, accessories, are now part of our plug-and-play system that as easy as slipping that cable into that slot, you're all set and powered and ready to go on your train track. So purchase this Santa's Helper set and you will then have instant access to really to start expanding your set very, very easily. That is a very important part of what we're doing here at Lionel in the world of accessories. We're trying very hard to make the fun of what is added to a train set with things beyond just what's on the tracks by things like the plug-and-play system. So if you haven't had a chance to look at it or purchase it yet, please take a good look at it. We have a number of items out right now, and Ryan had shown the single plug-and-play. We also have here, I just want to make sure everybody's aware that Lionel has this. If you have multiple accessories, for instance, this one has three ports, so you can plug in three, and that gives you, basically, it gives you power, instant power, from your train track to your accessory. That one also has a switch on the side, and it also comes with a little power pack on the side that allows you to plug that in a different way for powering it outside of your track. So the switch allows you to choose then between auxiliary power or track power. So as you grow your system in plug and play, you'll have the track pieces and you'll have the accessories that are going to allow you to grow in the system. Many of the plug and play products, like that icing station, come with a new little control switch box. And I think the design of those little switch boxes are really neat. I think we have one here, Mike, that might be sitting loose. Something like this will come in the accessories, operating accessories that may have more than one action. So something like a burning switch tower where you have the lighting on the inside and you've got the man who runs down and you've got the smoke or whatnot. You've got an on-off switch that allows you to turn on certain portions. So let's say you just turn that on and your lighting is on. You also have a momentary switch that's built into that same box that allows you to, whenever you would like, to access or activate an initial action from that accessory. So that's the world of plug and play for what we have for our traditional line. I think at this point, Mike, unless I've missed something obvious, maybe we could take a look at the American Flyer. American Flyer, of course, is an important part of our line. And most recently, we've released the Polar Express Berkshire, which is not what Ryan is holding up. On the tail of the Polar Express, we've released some prototypically accurate real railroad Berkshires, and he's holding up the Southern right now. We have it in a Pier Marquette and Nickel Plate and CNO and Erie, I believe, is the complete roster of Flyer Chief Berkshires that we have for American Flyer. Now, these are really nice engines. They're scale sized. They have a lot of nice detail on them and a lot of great features. You have your Rail Sounds RC for these. You have synchronized smoke. There's flickering firebox in your cab. Directional lighting, so you have an extra, there's an LED light on the back of your tender. Yes. Flyer Chief, for these, Berkshires also have an electrocoupler. That is different from the Polar Express, so I'll just make that very clear, that these are a step up from the Polar Express Berkshire in that regard. So a lot of great features. The tender, too, is a higher quality tender with the nice six-wheel die-cast trucks, stamped metal frame, and a die-cast body on that tender. And with these, being a Flyer Chief engine, there are switches on the piece, or you can switch it for whether you want your smoke on and off or your sound on and off, but you also have a switch for whether you want to operate this with your remote control that would come with the engine, or whether you'd prefer to operate it traditionally through, an AC transformer. So lots of different options for you American Flyers with Flyer Chief. And another great thing with Flyer Chief as well, and this ties everything back into what we're doing with Lion Chief Plus, which Mike had just shown that version that we're offering to the museum as a thank you. That Lion Chief Plus, even the Lion Chief that we have here, and the Flyer Chief, they all are part of a family of products that now, with our universal remote, you're able to control most of all of everything that we have done so far. So just to be clear, this is a universal remote that will control any Lion Chief Plus or Flyer Chief or most of your ready-to-run Lion Chief engines. There are, as an asterisk, a few early ones that you cannot control with this. But beyond that, this will control everything that's Lion Chief or Flyer Chief related. You have three buttons on here, and this isn't the final version, but the final version, the buttons themselves will actually illuminate, and it allows you very, very easily to set up and operate three engines from one remote control. And I think many of you might know, by having purchased now more than one of the Lion Chief Plus engines, that it'd be very, very convenient to be able to run everything from one remote. So it's really as simple as if you've got your, say, three different let's say it's a Lion Chief Plus engines on your layout. If this is on, it will recognize immediately that those engines are there, and it will automatically load those into your system. You're locked and loaded, so to speak, right at that point. And you're ready to run those three engines. At any time, if you want to switch engines, it's very easy to do. You just push a button, you hold it down for, say, 5 seconds or so, and it will take that out of its memory. The other great thing about universal remote is that if you turn off your system and you come back to it, all that information is still loaded into the memory. You're not going to find that you're going to have to keep reloading everything in. So it's very easy to use and very convenient and useful in the sense that it's part of our Lion Chief world, it's part of our Lion Chief Plus world, and our Flyer Chief as well. That covers everything that I have for, almost everything that I have for what I have to cover. We talked about the Berkshire and American Flyer. I just brought a couple of other classic sort of pieces for our American Flyer line, because we do want to make sure that we have some pieces here that we can talk with you guys and show off here at the museum for American Flyer. This is our new Union Starch tank car and a Redding hopper. Now the Redding hopper has the removable coal load insert, and these have the die cast metal trucks and everything that you've known and loved for the most part with our classic American Flyer cars. We're continuing not only with new pieces, new tooling such as the Berkshire, but also with some pieces that we've had in the line for a very long time. But you know, there's a lot of stuff out there we haven't covered yet. So we're really excited in all these different areas. We've just talked O and S, and of course there's G, and there's different lines that we have, and we urge all of you to investigate more and see what might be good for you and your family. And with that, I'd like to pass this on to Ryan. Okay, we'll talk about one more thing. These are the passenger streamliners. that are decorated in Delaware and Hudson. These were advertised a few catalogs ago, and these are being shown for the first time. Ryan has the observation car and the baggage car in his hand. And if you recall, Lionel had released a very cool legacy version of the Alco PA for both the Southern Pacific and Delaware and Hudson. So for any of these passenger cars that you're seeing now that are being released, if you are lucky to have purchased one of the Alco PAs, they certainly are going to be a nice fit for those engines. With that said, Ryan, is there anything else that I might have bypassed here?
No, I just feel like I need to say the emergency exits are located to the rear and the sides of the car.
But thank you all for your time, and I look forward to hearing what Ryan has for us.
Thank you very much, Matt. Well, take us from the worlds of American Flyer and sets into the realm of the O-scale locomotives and rolling stock. Matt or Mike, if you could, we'll back the train up and start with the cabooses. So we have with us here at the museum, by the way, should add, we've just got a small sample here with us today. I think when you get over to York in the next couple of days, you'll see we have one of the strongest showings of early production and pre-production samples from our factories that we've had here at York in quite some time. So this is really just a little teaser for you right now. We decided not to bring the whole 53-foot trailer over to the parking lot. So you'll see plenty of more goodies when we get back to York. We'll start with two of our N5 cabooses. These are available now, and another round of these just arrived at our warehouse earlier this week. So you'll be seeing some more of the road names that haven't hit your dealers yet. You'll probably be getting a nice email and a call when you get back from York. So if you have some more scale freight cars on order, you might want to spend accordingly while at the show. Two different versions that we brought here to help show some of the detail variations that we've done on our N5 cabooses. We have the Conrail and the Penn Central. These cabooses, we've taken to a new level of scale realism and detail. There are several different tooling modifications that were made so that we can do multiple variations of N5, N5A, and N5B cabooses from their as-built designs straight up through modernized versions. If you look at the ends of the cars, for example, here, see the Conrail version shows the way they were modernized in the late 1970s with the kick plate, the single flashing rear end device, modernized steps, versus the older kerosene lamps, the Pensy style ladders. We've done several different end cage versions, several different window versions, different smokes to get you to different smokestack locations depending on where that was located. The Conrail version has had its roof walk removed. Penn Central version still has its roof walk. So as you see these road names and you see these cars up close, I think you'll begin to appreciate a lot of the extra detail and a lot of the different variations that are going into not only our locomotives, but also into our new scale rolling stock as well. The GLA hoppers were also very much in that same vein. Next up, we have one that is literally so fresh out of the shop, you can still smell the paint on it. And that's one of our new rotary dump gondolas. These have been absent from the lineup for several years. We've brought the tooling back. We've done some upgrades on it and improvements. These are sold as two packs. These are being produced right now and will be on their way here very shortly. This is one of our final deco samples that arrived at York here this week. So we're seeing it for the first time as well. Features on these cars include a removable load and rotary couplers on one or two ends. One car in the two-pack has a single rotary coupler. The other has rotary coupler at both ends. So if you want to run this through a operating coal tipple or operating coal dump, you can do that and keep the cars still coupled together, as well as, of course, die-cast trucks. These cars are being made for us at a new supplier. When you take a look at these and turn the car up over, you'll notice the stamp on the bottom says Made in Romania. We have a new partner who's working on these cars as well as the milk cars that you saw in 2016 C2. So we are continuing to look for new partners and new ways to bring you the best product we can at the most affordable prices we can. And for their first project, we think they're doing a pretty good job. Also fresh in, and something that I know a lot of people have been anxious to see, are our samples of our new 21-inch passenger cars. We have two cars here from the Empire State Express set. This set will be the first of the 21-inch cars to deliver. These will be in dealers' hands by before the end of the year. We have the combine and the observation car here. Lots of exciting new features on these 21-inch cars. First thing I've got to point out, because it's right up there at the top of the complaint list for our past products, you'll notice the windows are mounted on the inside of the car body. Nice flush-fitting windows, they look great. Lots of detail inside and out on these cars. These cars also have, although the samples here don't show it, you'll see this at the fairgrounds, our kinematic coupler system on them. So they separate further on a curve and pull back together on straight track. So you get a nicer, more realistic coupling with the full or partial width diaphragms. Which diaphragm you get depends on the road name and the car. These cars also have a new feature in the lighting. They have LED lighting with a supercapacitor wired into the circuit board. So once that capacitor charges and you get full brightness on your layout after a couple of seconds, you will have guaranteed flicker-free lighting no matter how dirty your track is. You can actually take this car off the track, show it to your friends all the way around the room for 30, 40 seconds, put it back on the track before the lights go out. I think you'll enjoy that very much, although you'll have to figure out another way to determine when your track's dirty because you won't be able to tell from the flickering lights in the cars anymore. Another nice feature of these, for anyone who's ever taken apart one of our aluminum cars, these car bodies are held on to the frame with all of four screws, one in each corner. So if you want to do any additional detail work to the interior of the car, you simply take out four screws, put in figures, put the china on the dining room tables, whatever you want to do. They're easy to get in and out of, very easy to work on. Our customer service department is quite pleased with us for that one as well. Let's take a look at a few locomotives. We'll start with our Lion Master Challenger. The Lion Master line is another one that had disappeared from the catalogs for a few years and roared back into the line. We have the Challenger sample here. These locomotives offer all of the same great features of our larger full-scale legacy models. Including, in this case, whistle steam. Great legacy sound, electrocoupler, die-cast boilers, oodles of detail parts. Everything you want in a full-scale steam locomotive just crammed down into a slightly smaller size so it'll navigate an 031 curve without any problem. Very powerful engine. We've had this running around on our test track. It pulls everything we put behind it without any problem. And I think you'll be very, very pleased with these when you get them home. Next up, we have two sample shells here from our new SD40s. We'll have some more different shells over at the fairground, so you can check out more of the different detail variations on these. The two samples that we have here, one is a Conrail locomotive, and one is the Southern Pacific 7342, the quote, daylight version. Again, like the N5s, if you get a chance when you're at York, get up close to these, study them, look at all the different detail variations that we have worked into the locomotives. The Conrail version, for example, you'll notice the cab signal box, the grab irons have been relocated to the right side of the nose on that unit, correct horns, correct antenna details, the battery box covers on the sides of the cab are correct. So depending on which road you have, you'll see lots of different variations in these. Southern Pacific unit, for example, this was one of their locomotives that was rebuilt in the grip rebuild program at Sacramento Shops. So this engine is actually even has different details than the other Southern Pacific locomotives. You'll see these very distinctive, for example, split battery box doors under the cab window there on that Southern Pacific rebuild version, as well as, of course, the very distinctive Southern Pacific light packages on the nose and rear of the engine. In addition to the detail changes that you see here, these have correct truck side frames, correct size fuel tanks, we did our research on these to make sure we could bring you the most accurate O-scale SD40s that you've ever had a chance to buy. And I think the rivet counters will have some fun with these. One other feature on these that you won't get to appreciate from the shell, like the passenger cars, the SD40s have a kinematic pilot. This means that the plow and pilot section will actually pull out from the frame as you go around a tighter curve. In the catalog, we rated these at an 054 minimum curve, and they will do that no problem with anything you put behind it. If you're even just a little bit selective about the rolling stock you couple to the locomotives, you should have no trouble on these down to an 036 minimum curve. Very light cars, like some of our lighter hopper cars and traditional rolling stock, may get pulled off on a tight curve because of the coupler tension, but anything down to a scale 50-foot boxcar seems to operate without any problem down to 036 minimum curves. So if you were on the fence about that because of the minimum curve issue, there's a little bit of good news there for you. We're keeping the 054 minimum on that and the SD38 just because there are certain cars that it might not cooperate with, and we'd rather have you not be disappointed when you get it home. But with most scale cars, you'll have no trouble running these on tighter curves than 054. And last but not least, something that, unless you were with us at the Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania a few hours ago, you haven't seen yet. I give you the new Vision GG1, which will be premiered officially in the 2016 Signature Catalog. We're coming around with some handouts here for you on this locomotive as well. As many of you might be thinking, wow, GG1, I've seen that before. What are you gonna do to make that engine? I mean, it was already pretty awesome the last time you did it. Well, we've made a few changes to this in our constant quest to take everything and make it a notch or two better. Starting at the top of the unit, we've completely redesigned the pantograph assemblies. These are now sprung, so they will have a nice ride to them, just like the prototype, which means if you happen to bounce anything off of it, well, gently at least, I don't suggest you bounce bricks off of them, the pantograph will spring up and down. The pantographs are also remotely controlled from your legacy cab. If you change directions, the front pan will go up, the rear pan will go down, and vice versa. And what's really cool about these as well is we've worked in a set of LEDs into the pickup bars at the top. So as the train is running around the layout, you'll get that very distinctive white spark effect from the catenary arcing as it goes along. So you'll have a really cool spark and light and sound effect in the locomotive as it goes around, whether you have wire there or not. Something that will look really cool on any light, but especially if you turn the lights off in your train room and have that running around in the dark, that feature is really gonna jump out at you. Another great thing about these, one of the things that people really commented on with the Vision Big Boy was how great it sounded and how that whistle really had this tone to it that you couldn't get from any other locomotive with the stereo speakers. Well, we've upgraded and repositioned the speakers in the GG1 as well, so you'll get that great deep bass air horn from the GG1 in full stereo sound out of the locomotive. I'm sure that will be a real winner as well. All the other fun legacy features, the die-cast body, the smoke unit for the steam generator, oodles of details on it, and one of the other big announcements for this, for those who think you have all the GG1s you could ever need, we are doing not only the original, or I shouldn't say the original, the welded car body versions, we are tooling an all-new shell so that we can do 4,800 old rivets accurately as well. So that the riveted version will be available in its as-delivered 4899 color scheme, in the five-stripe Raymond Loewy paint scheme that it wore here at Strasburg in restoration for many years, and then also the Conrail Bicentennial scheme. So you'll have three options for riveted car body GG1s, and you'll have five options for different paint schemes and numbers on the welded version. Those will also have some select road name and road number specific details added to them as well. There's three Pensy welded, a Penn Central, and an Amtrak version of that locomotive, which you'll see in the brochures and see online on our websites. So as you can see, we're still moving forward. We've got a lot of great things. Swing by the booth, lots more scale locomotives, traditional locomotive sets, things that we couldn't pack up and bring here, as well as other things being demonstrated on the layout all weekend long. Thank you. I again, on behalf of everybody here and everybody back home at Lionel, for the continued support we get from the TCA, from the National Toy Train Museum, and all of you here at Strasburg and joining in from around the world. Thank you. Does anybody have any questions they'd like to toss at us?
The 21-inch car, are they going to be detailed for each car, inside and outside, and also for when it rotates in the future?
The question was, on the 21-inch passenger cars, were they going to be detailed inside and outside, and road name specific for each of the cars? There will be a mix. The cars that you see here for the Empire State Express will be correct for the Empire State Express. And there are a number of different detail parts that we will change in and out to make them more or less accurate for the other road names that we've done in this round. Going forward, we do intend to tool up some more new passenger cars, and they will be also road name detail specific for various trains. For example, the Union Pacific passenger cars that were previewed or sort of sneak peeked in the last catalog, those will be all new tooling, and they are based on the Union Pacific excursion train designs and drawings. So those cars will be correct. We will also, like we did with the 18-inch cars, we will offer some cars in more or less what we would call a generic detail level, detail packaging. So they'll have certain details like whether or not the side skirts are on or narrow or wide vestibules. Those details we'll be able to capture. A lot of the roof details we can either put on or take off to match the look of the car. But the window patterns and interior patterns may not be exact for some of those other road names. Other questions?
Is there any consideration of making more cars? Because the Empire State left New York City with a lot of cars.
Down the road, we could do some additional add-on cars, yeah.
Like the excursion, like UP excursion, they run, you know, two fistfuls full.
I think as time rolls on, we'll continue to put out additional cars for some of these sets. A lot of it will depend on the popularity of the first rounds. Any other questions? We did pretty well. We must have answered them all. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes, they are plastic. More aluminum cars, probably not, to be honest with you. To be flat out honest, the day of the aluminum car at Lionel is pretty much over. The manufacturing lead time on those and the fallout rate on those cars is so high, as you probably have already figured out from how quickly we've delivered the rest of the aluminum passenger cars from previous catalogs. We can get you much faster turnaround time on these. We can get you a good high quality product at a consistent price level and do more of these road name and detail changes and so forth, because the tooling is much easier to accomplish on the plastic cars. From the finish on these cars, we think they look very good. It's as close to an aluminum looking car as you're going to get without the weight and cost and difficulties that we have with aluminum cars. So that's where we are at this point. Will Lionel do an aluminum car again somewhere down the future? Hey, it's possible. But in the immediate time frame, we're going to be working with the plastic cars going forward.
Sir?
The Keystone? It's something I would look at and consider. It's a very specialized car, very specialized train. Not sure, but I'll take a look at it. Yeah. Any other questions? All right. Thank you all.
Thank you.